get the date time on here. Time lapse. We'll get the date on here. Shows what we're shooting. I just get Mary on there a little bit, and then we'll take it from there. I don't know how this thing is going to work, but there you go. There's Stanley Howe stuffing his face.
Get a good picture of Geraldine right now.
Pardon? Yeah, I get
best side.
Geraldine's
best,
best
side.
Side. Getting a little local color on the front of this while I'm getting the thing arranged here. Well, Rodney was there somewhere now. I get Rodney's best side there, I guess. Just trying this out here. Yeah?
Well, look at that. Isn't that pretty? That's old of an eye. That's pretty old.
Minister
gave him a pretty good thrashing, dragged him back in the same manner. You can't believe the transformation that took place in that young man. He became my model of discipline for the other students to follow. Well, I had decided that I would become a minister. But I knew in order to achieve that goal, I would need to further my education, so I applied to go to college, entered with the class of 1848, graduated in 1852 as a Phi Beta Kappa, and I'm obviously proud of that achievement. And then in the fall, returned to Bangor, entered Bangor Theological Seminary in 1852, studied 3 years for the ministry, and that was the turning point, because I had to prepare my master's paper, and I was fascinated with the topic of law and liberty, chose that as my master's thesis, and was invited to Bowdoin College before I graduated to deliver my paper, and it left such a favorable impression on the trustees, they invited me to become a professor at Bowdoin College upon my graduation from the seminary, and the lure of teaching was just so strong, I accepted and settled in the Bowdoin College and celebrated, ladies and gentlemen, by getting married on December 7th of 1855. And I married the daughter of the minister of the First Parish Church in Brunswick, Maine, Fanny Adams. And we settled into life at Bowdoin College. 1857, we had our first child, a son was born, and then in 1858, daughter was born, so we had two children in that intervening time before the war began. And that that was good, ladies and gentlemen, as you shall learn later on. When the war began, of course, when Abraham Lincoln was elected president in 1860, and our own Hannibal Hamlin from just down the road here in South Paris, to South Carolina, that was unbearable. A Northern president, and South Carolina feared that the government now, the national government, would be an abolitionist government. And in December, South Carolina seceded from the Union. Now, that created a problem for other Southern states, because if other Southern states remained as they were, it wasn't going to be long before South Carolina was going to be forced back into the Union. And if that happened, other Southern states knew they would never again want to talk about secession. So after Lincoln's inauguration on March 4th of 1861, six more Southern states seceded from the Union, part of that in support of South Carolina's stand. Delegates met in Mobile, Alabama, and elected Jefferson Davis president of the Confederate States of America. And then, of course, as we know, on April 12, 1861, Confederate forces fired on Fort Sumter down off Charleston, South Carolina, in the harbor, and we were thrown into Civil War. Would you believe that the Union Army only numbered 16,000 troops war began? So obviously for Lincoln, a major concern was to build up an army in a hurry. And he had to turn to volunteers. And of course, volunteer regiments began to be organized. The 1st and 2nd Maine Infantry obviously were the very quickest regiments to organize, and both of those regiments fought at the First Battle of Bull Run in the summer of 1861. Although I had serious thoughts about what was happening, I was still enjoying life back at Bowdoin College. Really hadn't thought much about volunteering my services at that point in time. Of course, the situation only worsened for the Union. General George McClellan was appointed commander of the Army of the Potomac. And in the summer of 1862, of course, McClellan, with 125,000 men, decided he was going to attack Richmond, capture Richmond, and end the war and end the Confederate marching towards Richmond via the old Yorktown battlefield where Cornwallis had surrendered, ending the Revolutionary War, in essence giving us the freedom that we celebrate today. 125,000 Union troops under Sergeant McClellan's command. And Robert E. Lee was defending Richmond with less than 80,000 Confederate troops. In charge of McClellan's spy network was Mr. Pinkerton, probably more well known as a detective. But he was in charge of McClellan's spy network, and he told McClellan, he said, "I have now the figures. I can tell you how many troops Lee has got in Richmond. He has 200,000 soldiers defending Richmond." McClellan said, "Well, my 125,000 looks small against 200,000. So he wired President Lincoln to send him some reinforcements. He wanted 40,000 more men, and Lincoln said, "No." He said, "If I send you 40,000 men from Washington, what will happen if Lee decides to make a rapid advance to Washington? He would probably capture our nation's capital." He said, "No." So on May 31st, fighting broke out between troops under Lee's command and under McClellan's command. May 31st at Seven Pines, major fighting. And at that battle, the commanding general of the forces of Virginia was seriously wounded. The next day, Robert E. Lee took command of what he termed the Army of the Potomac. Not the Potomac, the Army of Northern Virginia. On June 25th, McClellan finally decided to attack Lee at Richmond. And as the Union were attacking the lines around the Seven Hills of Richmond, Confederate troops were able to pry Porter's troops on the Union left wing. He pried them loose, and the whole left wing of the Union Army started to just withdraw. When McClellan saw this happening, he was so afraid that Lee was going to come out from behind the lines and attack him that he ordered a withdrawal of his troops, and they began to withdraw back to their gunboats on the James River. And of course, Lee used that as an opportunity then to go on the attack, even though he was greatly outnumbered. And the next 7 days was heavy fighting until McClellan and his troops finally got down to the cover of their artillery at Malvern's Hill, and Lee couldn't move any further. Now, while this is taking place, I'm still back at Bowdoin College. Now I am getting seriously disturbed about our country's situation. And I started to express my feelings verbally with trustees and other members of the faculty at Bowdoin College. I was terribly disturbed about the issue of secession. I need to tell you, I had angry feelings against the Southern states. Although I believed that slavery was wrong, ladies and gentlemen and young folks, I felt even stronger about secession. And I was so verbal that the trustees feared that I might do something rash, like join the Union Army, and they granted me a two-year leave of absence, a sabbatical leave to travel and study in Europe, and I accepted. And then my conscience simply got the better of me, and I traveled to Augusta, and I met with Governor Israel Washburn from Livermore, New Orleans, Washburn family, and I asked the governor if he would consider giving me a commission with a new Maine regiment being formed, the 20th Maine Infantry. And he offered me a full colonelcy in command. said to me, he said, "Chamberlain, look at that man." He said, "That is absolutely abominable." You get the word abominable, not abominable. He said, "That is absolutely abominable." And then he hollered to the man. He said, "The least you can do, man, is pull up your bowels." Terrible. Well, he also let it be known to me he didn't think we had much of a regiment. He really had no words of kindness to speak, but I want to tell you, when the war was over, he was singing praises for the 20th Maine, and still does today. September 2nd, we left South Portland. Took a boat to Boston, and then Boston by train to Maryland, and then we went marching into Washington. Following McCollum's defeat at Richmond, Lee took 3 weeks to decide what he was going to do, and he then decided he was going to march his army north into Maryland. Okay? He had three or four objectives. Maryland was a border state, ladies and gentlemen, of extreme importance to Lincoln and the Union. But a lot of people in Maryland were sympathetic with the Confederate cause. So Lee felt maybe if he could gain a victory in Maryland, Maryland might join the Confederacy. Think of the tremendous pressure on Washington now. Plus, he wanted to get Union troops up out of Virginia. So by marching his army into Maryland, of course, the Union army was going to come up from Virginia to keep tabs on him, so to speak. Plus, England was sympathetic to the Confederacy, and he felt if he could gain a victory on northern soil, maybe England will diplomatically recognize the Confederacy as a sovereign government, and then free trade could flow between States and England, and think of the supplies, the importance of the supplies that the Confederate States would take. But as things so often happen, Lee's plans didn't work out the way he had hoped. He issued 14 sets of orders outlining his plans to his officers, and they camped on grounds at Frederick, Maryland, and then when they vacated those grounds, lo and behold, some Union soldiers came in and occupied the same ground that the Confederates had a few days before. And a Union private, as he was walking about the grounds, he looked down and he saw a package of cigars lying there. It was a white sheet of paper wrapped around those cigars, and when he picked them up, I suspect probably he was more interested in the cigars, because someone tells me they were not just ordinary cheap cigars, they were very fine cigars. But unwrapping the paper, guess what he has? He has one of those 14 sets of orders that Lee has issued to his top generals, clearly outlining Lee's plans to march through Antietam, Maryland. Those were forwarded to McClellan. McClellan marched the Army of the Potomac over to Antietam to meet him. And on September 9th, orders came to the 20th Maine in Washington, start making a rapid march to Antietam, Maryland, to join up with the Army of the Potomac. And of course, there on September 17th of 1862, the Battle of Antietam, Maryland, was fought, probably the bloodiest battle of the entire war. At day's end, Antietam Creek with the blood of the dead and the wounded and the dying. The creek was flowing red in color. That's how terrible the Battle of Antietam was. A lot of fighting took place in a 60-acre cornfield. You and I are familiar with the cornfields of Maine. And during the battle that day, Confederate troops started feeding into the cornfield, and the Union troops started moving into the cornfield, that 68-acre cornfield, to meet them. And when the day was over, there was march across one single stone bridge. You can imagine. They were four men side by side, thousands of them marching across that stone bridge. What a wonderful target they made for the Confederate artillery and the Confederate infantry men. It wasn't a Union victory. It certainly wasn't a victory for Lee, but at least from one perspective, it was a Union victory because it prevented Lee from gaining a victory in Maryland. He had to turn back and retreat back to Virginia. So one could consider it, I suppose, a victory from that sense. Lincoln hailed it as a major Union victory. I'll tell you why. Lincoln was under tremendous political pressure because the Union Army had been doing so poorly during the early months of the war, and he'd been trying to make a decision, how am I going to get this political pressure off my back? And he decided he'd do so by issuing an Emancipation Proclamation. Ladies and gentlemen, Abraham Lincoln did not want to do that. It was his preference to win the war without taking such measures. But he needed to get the pressure off, so he hailed Antietam as a major Union victory, issued his preliminary Emancipation Proclamation, which was officially issued in January of the next year, and he fired General McClellan. General McClellan was actually fired and left the Army and became a railroad executive in New York City and would run against Lincoln for the presidency in 1864, but would lose. Lee retreated back to Virginia. McClellan has been fired. Lincoln called in General Burnside. He said, "General Burnside, I'm going to appoint you the commanding general of the Army of the Potomac." General Burnside said, "I don't want the job, Mr. President. I don't have the skills." President Lincoln said, "I don't care what you think. You are now the commanding general of the Army of the Potomac." Then Burnside decided he was going to do what McClellan couldn't do. He was going to catch Richmond and end the war. But he didn't put us on boats and have us go by boat. He marched us all the way from Maryland. We marched all the way down to the Virginia Peninsula. And Burnside was going to attack Richmond, and he was going to go by way of Fredericksburg. We arrived in Fredericksburg on November, the 4th of November of 1862, and we were waiting for some pontoon boats to arrive so that we could put the boats across the Rappahannock River, and then we were going to go across into Fredericksburg and occupy the town and the heights of land that lies behind Fredericksburg. And they didn't arrive. By the time the pontoon boats arrived, Robert E. Lee had already marched his army into Fredericksburg and occupied Fredericksburg and Maurice Heights. Then on the morning of December 13th was when Burnside launched an all-out assault on Fredericksburg and then attempted to capture Robert E. Lee's troops atop the heights, which were about a mile behind the town. And as the Union troops fed in and started marching across that 1 mile open plain towards the heights, as Lee's heavy artillery opened fire, just whole sections of the Union line disintegrated before your eyes. Where men had stood in a puff of smoke, they would be gone. At noontime, on December 13th, the 20th Maine Infantry were given orders to attack the very center of Maurice Heights. All of these soldiers. You know, ladies and gentlemen, when the sun was shining, it was cool when we started in the battle. And you know, in the heat of battle, you start to sweat, and they had taken their coats and left them behind, and they had taken their blanket rolls and they had left them behind. All of the essential elements were left behind for the quartermasters to take care of, so that when the night came and the temperature started to drop, those who had been men marching into battle became little boys when the darkness came. The air was filled with the sounds of the wounded crying for their mothers, crying for their wives, crying for God, crying for water, crying even for someone to come along and end their pain and suffering. And as the night wore on, as the temperatures dropped, the voices got fewer and fewer and fewer in number, of course, as they died there that night. And I want to tell you something. I was so cold that I dragged the bodies of 10 two dead Union soldiers to lie between that night. And I lay a third one across to kind of serve as a pillow, and I used the flap of his coat to cover my face from the cold winds, because the winds were blowing. And as I lay there, the wind was blowing a shutter, one of the buildings in the town of Fredericksburg, back and forth. It was banging, and it started to speak to me. And it spoke but two words as it banged back and forth. Never, forever, forever, never, all night long. Those were the words I heard it say. I'll never forget those words in my life. We lay there all the next day, ladies and gentlemen, and the only thing that was protecting us by then were the bodies of our dead comrades. And you know, I want to tell you, in plain terms, it was difficult. It was difficult not to get sick in the stomach as you could hear the Confederate ball thudding into the dead bodies that were protecting us. It was not until darkness of the second night that we were able finally, with some protection, to retreat from the field at Fredericksburg. But you know, there was one thing that the 20th Maine had to do. We had to bury our dead before we left the field. So using broken muskets, pieces of wagon boards that we found, we dug shallow graves, we laid our comrades to rest, and we started to retreat back across the river, and guess what? No more had we completed the task than the skies of Virginia, Fredericksburg, filled with the northern lights. A rather unusual phenomenon that far south. The whole sky filled with northern lights, and as I looked at them, I could not help but think they were shining over the home state of Maine in tribute to those Maine men chancellor's bill, but of course that was a costly one because Stonewall Jackson was seriously wounded on the evening of May 2nd by his own men, and he died 10 days later, which was a terrible loss to the Confederate Army. By the way, 20th Maine Infantry did not participate in the Battle of Chancellorsville. We were mustered in such a hurry that we didn't get our smallpox vaccine, and it just so happened that prior to the Battle of Chancellorsville, 35 men came down with the smallpox, and we were quarantined and given orders to guard the telegraph lines. I was absolutely furious. I met with General Hooker, and I said, "General, let us fight." I said, "If nothing else, we can contaminate the enemy and give them smallpox as well and reduce their troop strength." He did not think that was very humorous. We guided the telegraph lines. Following the victory at Chancellorsville, of course, then he had pretty much free opportunity to put his army on the move, was heading for Pennsylvania. Again, he was still hoping maybe he could achieve some of those objectives that had eluded him at Antietam. He was still hoping maybe he could gain a victory on northern soil, get recognition from England, maybe Maryland might still join the Confederacy. Plus, one of his other plans, he thought if he could gain some victories and defeat the Union Army in Pennsylvania, you know, he was going to go marching up into New York, and then was going to swing back around New York, Philadelphia, and capture Washington. That was part of his long-range plan. But I'll tell you who failed him. His commanding general in charge of the Confederate cavalry, Jeb Stuart, got way off somewhere. Lee lost all contact with Stuart. Didn't know what the Union troop strength was there, and the two armies, of course, came together on July 1st, 2nd, and 3rd of 1863, more by accident, ladies and gentlemen. It was not planned for the battle to take place at Gettysburg. Of course, Hooker was relieved of command, and General George Meade was commanding the Army of the Potomac at the Battle of Gettysburg. On July 1st, let me tell you why it was kind of an accident. On July 1st, General A.B. Hill of the Confederates took some of his troops in. They were heading for the town of Gettysburg because they learned that there were being some shoes manufactured there, and they were needing some shoes, so they were heading for the town to get some shoes. And as they approached the town, lo and behold, they came up against some Confederate Union cavalry under the command of General Reynolds. Both sides were somewhat surprised because they didn't expect either side to be there, and of course skirmish broke out, and then it started to escalate into a major fight, and both sides were feeding in troops, and a major battle took place on July 1st. Ended pretty much in a stalemate because the Union troops still occupied Cemetery Ridge at day's end. That evening, Lee decided to try to flank the left of the Union lines, slide right around the Union lines and attack from the rear, split the Union lines up, gain the victory. Jeb Stuart, still off somewhere. Lee and General Longstreet thought that the Union lines only extended a short distance from Cemetery Ridge. When Longstreet rode out on the afternoon of July 2nd to begin the Confederate attack, what he realized is that the Union lines extended much further south, and he wasn't making a flanking attack. He was attacking what was the center of the Union lines. And 367 men from Maine were given the orders to occupy Little Round Top and prevent Confederate troops from flanking Union lines. Our orders were, at all cost, you cannot let the Confederate troops slide around your rear because they'll roll up our lines and gain a major victory. The 20th Maine only had 200 service. They were mustered in as a three-year regiment. And then somehow in a mix of orders, after the first Battle of Bull Run, all but 120 of them were mustered out of service. And the other 120 were told they still had a three-year enlistment. They weren't very happy. In fact, they were so angry, they then and there decided they are not going to fight anymore. So as we were marching to Gettysburg in late June, I was given those 120 mutineers from the former 2nd Maine and told that if I couldn't get them into shape, I had free orders to shoot. Free orders to shoot. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that was the last thought I had in mind. Plus, when they mutinied, by the way, and said they weren't going to fight anymore, then the Army stopped issuing them rations. I haven't had anything to eat for several days. The first thing I did was I ordered the cooks to prepare a decent meal, and I said, feed them up. That's the first thing I did. And after they ate hearty, and I got them a little better clothing, then I gathered them together and I said, men, you have been wrong. I know that. There isn't anything I can do about it. I will make every effort I can. You have been wrong. 119 of them then volunteered with the 20th Maine. They became part of the 20th Maine. And those 119 plus the 240 repulsed five attacks by a far larger Confederate force on the afternoon of July 2nd. All but one decided he still wasn't going to join up. He was thrown into prison, and after a few days in prison, he decided he too would become a member of the 20th Maine. I want to describe the last attack. 4th and 5th Texas, 5th, 47th, 4th Alabama regiments, 2,500 Confederate troops attacking 360 men of the 20th Maine Infantry. We turned them back on every charge. Men were out of ammunition. I looked down the hill, and there they were assembling for still another charge up that hill. And as they came up the hill, I ordered the men to fan out in a single line, kind of on a 45-degree angle, one single line, and as those Confederates came charging up, I gave the orders, bayonets in advance. Men fixed their bayonets. We started to charge them, and the left began to wheel and close like a barn door on those Confederate troops. And as the door or the wheel began to close, Company B, which had been pinned down, finally came out from behind where they had been pinned down. We thought they had all been killed. And they came into battle, and the Confederates thought that there was a large number of reinforcements coming in. They literally turned and ran down that hill, and we captured 400 of them in the process. I was awarded a Congressional Medal of Honor. I was wounded, struck by a ball that hit me in the boot during the battle. So the 20th Maine is given credit for saving the day. And then, of course, the next day, July 3rd, Robert E. Lee decides to make an all-frontal assault on the center of the Union line, suffers a terrible, terrible defeat that afternoon. issue with his troops. We're on May 10th. Grant ordered Union troops to attack Lee along the whole earthworks, and during that one day's battle, we suffered 10,000 casualties. Then it started raining heavy that night. Lee figures he's in a tough situation, so that night he retreats from Spotsylvania, headed towards Richmond. A few miles from Richmond is Cold Harbor. And there he occupied Laurel Hill. And then on June 2nd, 3rd, Grant orders Union troops to attack Laurel Hill. Would you believe in the first half hour of the attack, 8,000 Union soldiers became casualties in the first half hour? Lee decided he was pressed. Grant decided he wasn't going to attack Richmond. He was going to try to capture Petersburg 20 miles south. Lee retreats to Petersburg. June 18th, we attack all of his lines at Petersburg, and during the battle there, as I was standing side to directing the attacking forces, I was struck by a mini-A ball, hit in front of my right hip, passed completely through my body and exited to the rear of my left hip. By the way, mini-A balls are conical in shape, they're hollow, and they flatten about the size of a quarter. So you can imagine the hole that ball tore through. And a surgeon examined me after they carried me back to the field hospital. He examined me and said I was going to die in a matter of minutes and left. My brother Tom, who was serving with the 20th Maine, he heard I had been wounded. Dr. Abner Shaw was a physician with the 20th Maine. He found Dr. Shaw. He said, can you go and at least attempt to give aid to Colonel Chamberlain? They finally found me, and with the assistance of Dr. A.W. Townsend, who was with the 44th New York, they worked 9 hours on me, artificially patching me together. And would you believe that I had some hope that I was going to survive? Although 2 days later, I was reading the Washington newspapers, reading my obituary in the obituary section. I was sent back to a hospital in Maryland for 5 months. And of course, they were still fighting at Petersburg through July 31st. Now, I just want to share quickly that with you, and I'll kind of bring things to a close. July 31st, Union decided to try to break through the Confederate lines. And they had some Pennsylvanians serving with Pennsylvania regiments, former coal miners. They had them dig a tunnel from the Union lines about 200 yards underground, right up under the center of the Confederate line, and they planted 8,000 pounds of black powder right under Fort Stedman. 4:30 in the morning, they lit the fuse. The troops were ready to attack once the explosion took place. And at 5:30, there wasn't any explosion. Someone surmised the fuse must have gone out. So a brave Pennsylvanian says, I'll volunteer to crawl inside the tunnel. He did. The fuse had gone out when they had been spliced together. He relit it. A short while later, that 8,000 pounds of black powder blew a crater 167 feet long, 60 feet wide, 60 feet deep, right in the center of the Confederate lines. And then the Union troops began to attack left and right of that giant crater. And would you believe Burnside was commanding that attack? Burnside's on the scene again. And as the Union troops got up to the sides of the crater, would you believe they're attacking the enemy? They looked down in that giant hole. They were so mesmerized by the hole, they stopped the attack and they started walking down in to explore the crater. And the crater began to fill up with Union troops. And the 57th Massachusetts Regiment was part of the attack, and their orders were to attack through the crater. There were regiments attacking left. Lee's army had dwindled down to less than 27,000, and his men were deserting in large numbers, and he simply couldn't build his army up. I was back in service in November, and then I got sick again, sent me back to the hospital in Washington, and then in February of 1865, I was back with the troops, leading an attack along the Quaker Road, and found myself coming to, having been struck by a ball again. My head was lying on my horse's neck, and when I lifted my head there, the horse was bleeding profusely from the neck. I was bleeding from the side of the neck. And then it dawned on me that the ball had struck the horse first, and it had deflected it. And by deflecting the ball, it went right up my rib cage and came out the side of my neck. But I also, ladies and gentlemen, came to the realization that the horse saved my life, and that when my blood mingled with the blood of the horse, I made a blood-brother relationship with the horse. That was the thought that came across my mind, and I was forever thankful for that. Lee then, of course, after the Battle of Five Forks on April 1st, 2nd, and 3rd, he had to abandon Five Forks, and he headed for Appomattox. And he had a railroad train waiting with supplies for his men, food and supplies. And then he was going to get those supplies, and then he was going to march down into North Carolina, because General Johnson had about 30,000 Confederate troops in North Carolina. He felt if he could join up with them, he at least could probably put that together, about 67,000 Confederate troops, and maybe keep the fighting going. Phil Sheridan was commanding the Union cavalry. He found out about the train. He started for that train. He captured the train before Robert E. Lee got there, and he also cut Lee off from any attempt to be able to march into North Carolina. April 9th, Robert E. Lee finally, at Grant's request, met with Grant in the McLean House, where Grant offered him terms of surrender, which Lee would accept. By the way, I want to tell you, I happened to see Robert E. Lee as he rode into Appomattox that day. The man looked like a god to me. He had on a brand new Confederate general uniform, was wearing a bright silver sword that the Virginia legislature had presented to him. I stood in awe of the man, if you can believe that. Grant offered him these terms: immediate parole for all of his men after the surrender. They could go home. They could take their horses and mules home with them, get the crops in that they were going to need to get them through some difficult times. Grant accepted the terms. That evening, I was told I was going to have the honor of receiving Grant Lee's surrender on April 12th. And on the morning of April 12th, ladies and gentlemen, without asking any higher authority, I decided, when I saw the Confederate troops assembling for the surrender march, that it wasn't going to be a walk of humiliation. That was the last thing I was going to allow happen. I decided that we were going to give them a full military salute when they passed us on the road. And I want to tell you why. Because when I looked into the faces of those Confederate troops, and they looked more like dead men, living dead men, than they did men, when I looked into their faces, what I saw was embodiment of mankind. Men for whom neither toils nor suffering, sickness, disease, death had kept them from fighting for the cause that they had believed in. They were worn, they were thin, they were famished, but they were waking memories for me, and those waking memories bound me together with them. And I said, this kind of manhood should be welcomed back into the Union with open arms. General John Gordon, who was leading them, got to my right. I gave the orders to the Union soldiers lining the roads to present their arms in the carry-on position, the salute of honor. And Gordon saw what was taking place. He acknowledged the salute, nodded at me, pointed his saber to his boot, and gave the orders to his men when they passed to return the salute of honor, and it changed the whole of the 6, what was left of the 20th Maine, 120, mustered out of service in Washington.